But is it possible to produce low-cost birds and achieve good animal welfare standards at the same time?
I'm on my way to an intensively reared chicken farm in the Peak District. The farmer claims to be using science to produce not only cheap but healthy chickens too.
I don't really know what to expect here, because when you mention intensive farming, I get an image of chickens in pretty bad condition. So can you honestly square the circle between healthy and cheap chicken?
Chicken farmer David Speller raises over 10 million birds a year. In this barn alone, there are nearly 50,000 30-day-old birds just starting to get their feathers.
There is a perception, I think, that intensive rearing of birds will result in unhealthy and sick birds.
There is no money for me as a farmer in unhealthy birds. If you're sick, you don't grow very well. And also you burn a lot of calories and energy producing antibodies to fight disease. So if I can keep the birds healthy, then they will eat less food to grow because they're less stressed, they're not fighting disease. They will then produce, for me, more weight quicker, which is good for my business. So that's where, for us as a company, we're on a mission using technology, data, all of science that we can to really understand what that chicken is thinking and wants.
David has spent around £500,000 on technology, which spots the first signs of illness in his birds by sniffing them.
What we're doing is we're taking air samples in through this tube, sucking them through an absorbent pad to capture the smell of the barn, the volatile compounds that are in this shed.
By analysing the odour that the chickens give off, this clever bit of kit allows David to predict if any of his birds are beginning to get sick.
This machine is sniffing the air and registering the smell. And if the smell changes, that could well be because the chickens are getting ill.
The living cells within an animal start to change when it's becoming sick or poorly. They give off different odour, different volatile compounds. Now, I can pick those up before you're actually sick. We can see a shift in that tiny smell 3 days before any physical symptom change in a bird.
Mate, you are a scientific chicken sniffer.
I am a long way beyond where I was as a farmer a few years ago, yeah.
Chicken sniffer.
Keeping his brood fighting fit also cuts down on something that many chicken eaters worry about, antibiotics.
Before the bird is physically ill and showing symptoms of being sick, I can use alternatives before I need to use antibiotics.
Forget chickens. All of us parents are going to want this for our kids. There's going to be one of these in every bedroom.
David's use of antibiotics has more than halved in recent years, thanks in part to this sniffer technology. But it's not just illness that can interfere with a growing chick. Stress has been shown to slow down growth too. So, David has a high-tech remote monitoring system to ensure he has chilled out chickens.
I don't want people going into my buildings unnecessarily and acting like a natural predator, stressing that bird, making it consume more food because it's stressed, more food, more cost to me. This is an example of where we are using very sophisticated technology, looking straight down on top of the birds. It's live streaming images into the software, processing those images to work out how much movement I'm seeing in my birds. Too much movement is suggesting to me they're stressed. Too little movement is suggesting they're stressed. I want them in an optimal place.
Chilled.
Chilled.
Zen.
I want them perfect.
With this remote monitoring, David can minimise stressful human visits and easily alter conditions in the barn if he thinks the chickens are too hot or too cold. And taking his attempts to know his brood even further, he's even trying to speak their language.
Now we're trying to effectively be Dr. Dolittle.
What?
That there are 10 or 11 things a chicken will tell you. So it'll tell you it's hungry, it's thirsty, it's hot, it's cold, it's stressed. So I am listening through modern technology, directional microphones, that from one location I can listen into one individual chicken amongst 45,000.
Okay, listen, I'm a little bit scared now. I'm gonna be going, okay? I'll try not to show fear as I'm backing away. This is crazy. This is too much.
It's all about the question why. Why does a chicken grow well? Why does a chicken fight off disease and remain healthy? Why does a chicken want certain things in its environment?
Why did it cross the road?
Why did it cross the road? I want to know the answer. That's who I am. That's what I want to know. But of course, I'm using that knowledge to commercial advantage.
Thanks to his high-spec bird tech, David Speller reckons he's saving over £40,000 a year. Now he's planning to become the first chicken farmer to use robots to help look after his brood.
We need to get down amongst the birds. We need to live with the birds. We need to be moving around with the birds 24 hours a day for the whole of their lives. This allows us to do that and get so much more information. Initially, we're talking about similar sensors to we're using now, but the great thing with this is it's modular. We can add on there any future technology as it develops.
The robots will be packed with sensors and will allow David to monitor the birds even more closely.
I think you're going to come in early one morning to find 12 chickens clinging onto that on their way out the gate.
They certainly love riding on it around the barn.
No way.
Definitely.
No way.
Definitely, yeah.
Okay. All right, listen, I didn't know what to expect today, but I certainly didn't expect what I found, and I most certainly didn't expect that. You are into chickens, seriously, like no man I've ever met. Okay, you really are. Wouldn't you rather pack this in and have free range, organic? Seriously.
I'm not against those sectors at all. For me, the issue is about trying to understand, using science, what that bird really wants. And to do that, I need it in an environment where I can monitor it, control it, observe it, and learn. What I've got here is a living laboratory telling me exactly what my animals are wanting. And I'm learning every day. And if it starts to tell me things that it wants, I'll give it, because then it'll be less stressed, it'll reduce its potential for disease, it'll grow better, it'll make me more money, everyone's happy.
David is taking a scientific approach and really trying to understand what makes his chickens happy. You might like it, you might not like it, but David loves it.
The more supermarkets know about how we shop, the more likely it is that they can keep us coming back and spending money. And they're investigating new ways of finding out just who is shopping and when. Of course, it's easy for supermarkets to know exactly what we buy at the tills, but they have no way of reliably knowing how many people go into store, whereabouts we go once we're inside, and whether that browsing converts into sales. Since new privacy laws came in 2018, the supermarkets are not allowed to gather any information that identifies us without our permission. So they're looking for ways to study our shopping habits that don't break the new law. One company thinks the answer to discrete data collection is by looking at our feet. The idea is that cameras filming our feet can give supermarkets valuable information about how we're using their store without identifying us. One of the first retailers to try it out is Iceland. Neil Hayes is their marketing director. So Neil, are these the cameras that have the foot fetish?
Yeah. Yes, they are. Small device, but really powerful in terms of giving us information. And it just focuses on the entrance.
Yeah.
So it just tracks the shoes that are coming in and out of the store. That then gives us the data that we can use.
Those cameras must have seen thousands of feet.
They're recording every single foot that steps foot into this Iceland store.
Neil thinks the trial is already giving him fresh insights into his customers.
What it's taught us is the volume of traffic customers coming in at one entrance versus a car park entrance.
Yeah.
And that's really important in terms of how we orientate the store. We want to put the right products near the entrance you know, things like fresh fruit and vegetable, our baked goods.
And is that the kind of information you could only have got from the cameras?
Absolutely, because otherwise you're just trying to monitor it manually, yeah. And a little bit of intuition. So the data gives you that kind of factual answer.
Understanding exactly how customers navigate the store means they can put displays where people will see them most and design the store layout to maximise sales.
And is there anything in it for us, the customer?
Yeah, a better store to shop. So, you know, and it's really interesting, some of the stores that we've refurbished and relayed and re-merchandised, you know, it's really common that you get customers give you feedback when you're in the store saying how much easier the store is to shop now. They can find things that they need.
It's not just helped them with store design. Extra cameras focused at feet in the high street have revealed untapped potential customers.
This is the footfall, as we describe it, on the high street outside. And you can see these 2 days here, which is a Thursday and Saturday, just how busy the high street is here because it's market day.
Yeah.
And then if you look at how busy the store is, we're busier on those days, but not to the same extent. So it shows us some opportunity that we could trade better on those 2 days. So really good insight for us.
The system is capable of more than just counting feet. Without identifying us, it can actually tell supermarkets a huge amount. Owen McCormack is the inventor.
We can tell whether you're male or female to about 80% accuracy.
But how does your technology actually do that? How do you distinguish between heels, flip-flops, boots?
Our software does it using artificial intelligence.
Okay. Yeah, because that's what I was going to ask you, Owen. What about the scooter?
So we are actually able to detect wheels.
Okay.
So things like scooters, prams, that sort of thing, we're able to count.
The software analyses the camera footage and creates a surprisingly detailed customer profile.
That's one of the big innovations that we've done. Based on the color, size, and pattern, and even brand of the shoes people are wearing, we can get that little bit of extra information about the kind of people that come into different stores.
This feet-first technology is still in its infancy, but this clever tool is already helping the supermarkets build a picture of who's shopping and how, without compromising our privacy.
I'm not really sure what to think about it, but if it really doesn't identify us and it does improve the way we shop, well, maybe it's a good thing.
To retain our loyalty, the supermarkets are desperate to know what their customers want from them, and probably more importantly, what they don't want.
It's become increasingly important for them to find out exactly what appeals to us and what turns us off different products and stores.
Traditionally, this has involved slow and expensive in-store market research. But now, some are turning to virtual reality. Cedric Guillet is head of analytics with retail consultants Kantar.
Think of this as kind of a game, the ones that you play with on your PlayStation, for instance, where except the fact that the environment that the shopper is in is a supermarket.
So, in this specially built virtual reality lab, test customers shop their way through a virtual supermarket as Cedric and his team observe their behaviour from behind a one-way mirror.
And why do you do this? What do you get from it?
We do this because we're trying to build new environments for shoppers. It's very costly if you try to do this physically. It's very disruptive. And so virtual reality enables us to change anything that we want and see whether shoppers understand it. It's about building an environment that really makes them want to come back because they like it.
The first experiment Cedric shows me investigates whether customers like or dislike various shelf layouts. So he's asked his test shopper to look for their preferred chocolates for a dinner party. It's already revealed something unexpected.
There is an inverse correlation between the time you spent at a shelf and the products you purchase. The more time you spend, the less likely it is that you're going to buy.
Really?
Yes, because people hate looking for stuff. Otherwise, they just go online and buy it there, which obviously the retailers don't want.
So the VR supermarket helps them design shelf layouts that speed up our shop. can also use the system to test that they're stocking exactly what we want. And I'm the next guinea pig.
Cedric, pass me that headset.
Thank you. Right. Here you go. Are you comfortable?
Oh, hello. Oh, my goodness. This is so lifelike, it's unbelievable.
Isn't it?
I can't even see my scooter. And that just floated in on me.
So we're going to give you the same mission that we gave to our mystery shopper earlier. You're going out and you're buying chocolates for a dinner party.
Am I a bit old school thinking black magic? Or am I thinking Terry's chocolate orange? It's a present. So I'm going to go with Ferrero Rocher.
This was really important because you told us already so much by looking at some of the product, considering, we looked at your eye movement, the chocolate you considered, and you made the final decision.
I did.
All this data gives Cedric valuable information about how we choose what we buy. But he's even more interested in finding out how we behave when we can't find what we want.
What we're going to do is, we're going to do it again.
Okay.
Except for one difference, there's no more Ferrero chocolate on the shelf. So what are you going to go next?
Please don't take my Ferrero Rocher away. So what's my second choice for a dinner party gift? Okay, so if I've not got any more Ferrero Rocher, I'm going to go with Milk Tray.
Very good.
Is that all right? This
will absolutely
be my second choice.
The reason why we're doing this is because we're trying to understand what we call substitutability.
Right.
So this idea of, if you no longer find your products, what are you going to go next? And next, and next, up to the point where you no longer find the products that you're looking for. At which point you're going to leave the store.
It's obviously important for the supermarkets to know when we're happy to accept a substitution and when they risk losing a sale. What Cedric has also learned is that the purpose of our shopping trip affects what substitutes we'll consider.
For instance, when you go and want to make a gift of chocolate, if you don't find the chocolate where you're going to go to wines likely.
Yeah.
Or you're going to go to flowers. So maybe there are opportunities to actually bring those products together to create a better gifting category.
Supermarkets are starting to use this research to create shelves with different combinations of products, like chocolates, flowers, and wines, to make sure they don't lose any potential sales.
The stores have a long life ahead of them. They're going to stay there. The question is, in what form? We're trying to help figure this out.
It's clear to see how this technology would benefit the supermarket and the suppliers. For us, the consumer, it's just a way of making us spend more money. But it does show just what supermarkets are having to do to try and keep our custom. Because if our favourite products are not on those shelves, we're off.